The objective of an inaugural is to actually crystallize your knowledge.
I'm really proud of her.
I know that at the end of today, the African woman will be made very proud.
The topic for the inaugural lecture is Gender Matters and the Cultural Dilemma in African Literature.
One unique feature of inaugural lectures which is advantageous today, considering the intensity and passionate nature of my topic, is that the audience has no right to be taught, as an inaugural affords a professor the singular opportunity to speak ex cathedra, to say practically anything he or she likes without being questioned or challenged.
Well, what inspired the topic? It's simply an outcome of my research over the years, over the 17 years I've been teaching at Babcock University.
What I hope to achieve, however, is not a dispassionate silence, but a process of reflection, contemplation, and concentration of the ideas that will reverberate in gendered relations, both in the corporate backup life and in personal relationships. My aim is to provoke thoughts through pertinent situations and deductions, so that by the conclusion of this lecture, the main issues surrounding gender and African culture can be understood, and gender relations in Africa will become more genuine, free, and complementary. Another practice of the inaugural lecture is an exposition of one's discipline and suggestion of practical ways in which that discipline can engage and impact the community. My lecture today will address aspects of my research that are of academic and communal interest. My research constitutes a tale of two pathways, gender and culture, specifically African oral literature. These two passions grew from divergent experiences. Gender as a challenge and a passion, oral literature as a destiny, my muse. Let me into
gender studies. I teach women, you know, writers in Africa. My master's research is in gender, okay? And my PhD research is in oral literature, particularly Yoruba drum poetry. So I needed to synthesize the two divergent research foci into one, and that's why I came up with Gender Matters and the Cultural Dilemma in African Literature.
Before I go into my assignment of crystallizing knowledge and contributions in the two distinctive areas of knowledge, Mr. President, Vice Chancellor, sir, permit me to state that today's lecture is a destiny fulfilled as I narrate the genesis of my destiny in the literary field. Ever since childhood, I relish stories. Meanwhile, gathered in Lagos, I was not opportune to listen to moonlight tales. Rather, I found my escape in reading. Before I finished secondary school, I was already decided about what to do, English literature to be specific. Of course, in our days, fathers decided what children would become. My father decided I was to study science by the time I reached form four, where one is to choose either science or arts. It was obvious to me from my average performance and struggle with mathematics that art class was the best for me. I did not get fooled about the myth of science students being more brilliant than art students. Though I was young, I knew my audience. My father would have none of my opinion. He ordered me with the connivance of the school's guidance counselor into the science class. First time in form four, I took 9 subjects, I had 6 A's and 3 X's. nursing or B. Maths, physics, chemistry, where X. I knew my star might not simply win, but might be extinct in the science class. My father would not budge. He insisted the reasons I failed science subjects were because I lived out of myself and lacked confidence. He accompanied me to the school and promised the guidance counselor I would perform better. As soon as I left, I carried my desk and chair to arts class. I sat behind. The teacher, who came to take attendance, was surprised and asked me to return to my class. Like Daniel in the Bible, I negotiated with her. She was afraid I would perform poorly since I did not do the first time with the class. To cut a long story short, at the end of the term, I got home with the boarding school, from the boarding school, and handed over my report sheets to my father, who was beaming with smiles as he saw A's in every subject. I thank God today because he did not collapse from shock when he began to see history, Yoruba, literature, etc. in the subjects. I had my way. My father considered a victory. I was on my destined path of arts. Little did I know my father had alternative plans. I must become a lawyer. He personally filled my jam form, choosing law at the University of Ibadan, even though I told him I wished to study English. I knew I couldn't win the battle. Even refused to make English my second choice. I was resolute. I knew my shortcomings. I hated cramming gates. And I ended up slapping the judge if your she pronounces an unjust judgment. But my father would hear none of that. But heaven gave me a life chance. When in my presence, he handed over my sealed jam form to a junior army officer to submit a jam office. As soon as my father left the scene, I cajoled the soldier to let me take a look. And I'm sure nothing was forgotten. The unsuspecting soldier handed the envelope to me. I quickly went in, tore the envelope, erased law as first and second choices, replaced with English, got a new envelope, and handed over to the unwavering soldier. My husband promised him I would not interrupt my private schooling when we got married after my first degree. Mr. President, Vice Chancellor, Sir, January 2005, with the support and doggedness of my husband, I fulfilled my promise to my father. This background set the stage for me to deliver today's inaugural lecture.
I want to showcase what I have been researching into, which is gender and oral literature. Okay? I want to be able to change and reshape gender relations in Babcock University as an institution, within families and within individuals, in the workplace generally. I want people to have the right perception about what gender relationship should be about, not about competition between sexes, but also it has to be with mutual respect for every gender. That's my aim, and that's what I want to give to the public so that it shapes and it helps to balance the way they relate to opposite sex at home, at the workplace, in the public.
This lecture is indeed a destiny fulfilled, a vocation attained. It is therefore with ringing beats in my heart to the unstoppable God who alone fulfills desires and destiny that I accept the honor to deliver the 22nd inaugural lecture of the university, the fourth in the School of Education and Humanities, and the very first in the Department of Languages. My study in English studies led me to two interrelated areas of gender studies and African oral literature, which informed the topic of my lecture, Gender Matters and the Cultural Dilemma in African Literature. Introduction. In many parts of the world, historically, women were portrayed and perceived as weak, emotional and dependent beings. Thus, they were trained to be useful to their husbands, attend to his needs, and take care of the children. In Europe, feminism has its origin in the struggle for women's rights in the 18th century, although some scholars have claimed earlier dates of women's struggle for their rights. Mary Wollstonecraft, 1792, and John Stuart Mill's 1809 were part of the major contributions to feminist literature. There have been major conferences on women, among which are those held in Mexico, 1975, Copenhagen, 1980, Nairobi, 1985, Beijing, 1995. Women have been in the quest for improved living standards, political rights, redress of financial and social and cultural restrictions to women and girls, with a focus on closing gender gaps, hence scholars have continually engaged women's issues from social, political, economic, and cultural disciplines. Conversely, while the male has been dominant in life and literature, very little research has been conducted on men's needs compared to women's issues. It is assumed that by having hegemony, men do not need to be studied like the females. Emerging studies in masculinities have drawn attention to issues on the construction of males, men's identity, and men's crisis, emasculation, the male dilemma, among many pertinent issues that need to be researched. Culture has been alleged to be a major source of gender inequality and oppression, especially for most women in Africa.
It just gives me the opportunity to showcase and to share my research interest in people. It doesn't have to bring some direct opportunities, but the more people get to know about what you're doing, then the more they know, okay, if people want to talk about gender matters or they want to talk about general cultural matters, they can consult me. I could speak, you know, in these areas, I could consult in these areas, I could give advice, and so on and so forth.
Culture comprises the ideas, customs, and social behavior of a particular people or society. It can be described as a set of attitudes, values, beliefs, and behaviors shared by a group of people, communicated from one generation to the next. Culture has been used in some African communities to justify the oppression of women, even in contemporary times. Dilemma is a situation in which a difficult choice has to be made between two or more options, particularly ones that are equally undesirable. It can result in forcing a person to choose either of two unfavorable alternatives. The concern of this lecture is to highlight the manner in which culture defines gender roles in contemporary Africa. This aim will be achieved by enunciating how cultural beliefs and traditional practices structure and shape gender relations, and how it has resulted in dilemma, not only for the females, but for males and females as portrayed in African literature. The utility of literature and exposure to good literary works is essential at every phase of life, as it enriches us in several ways. African oral literature. The indigenous knowledge of the Africans is generally archived in oral traditions and folklore. Tanuri Ojaide asserts that folklore is a repository of a people's indigenous and local knowledge in the forms of language, literature, legends, myths, epics, folktales, songs, proverbs, tongue twisters, riddles, music, dance, arts, religious beliefs and practices, medicinal treatments, and other customs and traditions. The content of oral literature reflects a people's culture, belief, and lived experiences.
I've known Professor Bola Shotusa for quite a while.
Gender refers to the social construction of sex differences. While sex is construed to relate to biological differences, that is, anatomical, physiological, or biological characteristics of an individual, that is, male or female, gender denotes the social and cultural role of each sex within a given society. In many societies, the system of gender relations gives power and privilege to men and discriminates against women. The gender order determines what is accepted, encouraged, and allowed for women and men. When the gender order privileges men, the social acceptance of male domination and female subordination may be sustained by many formal and informal institutions and practices.
The presenter is a foremost scholar in gender studies as well as oral literatures.
Gender equality and equity. Gender equality is a state or condition that affords women and men equal enjoyment of human rights, opportunities, and resources, allowing both sexes the same opportunities and potential to contribute to and benefit from all spheres of society.
The lecturer of today is a pride to the Languages and Literary Studies Department of Babcock University. She's a hard worker, a determined scholar, and very, very indefatigable. She's resolute to achieve whatever she wants to, and that is why she has made giant strides in the area of gender studies.
Equity refers to justice and fairness in the treatment of women and men in order to eventually achieve gender equality. An example of differential treatment may be provision of leadership training for women. it is important to note that equity is meant to lead to equality. The gender gap is a difference in any area between women and men. Women are often underrepresented in formal decision-making structures, including governments, community councils, and policy-making, and even academic institutions.
To achieve gender equity or equality, we need both the male and the female.
Culture comprises the distinctive patterns of ideas, beliefs, and norms which characterize the way of life and relations of a society or group within a society. Culture is versatile and all-embracing of both material and non-material objects and concepts. It entails the totality of a people's norms, ethos, values, beliefs, reason, the term, codes of socially acceptable conduct, modes of life, religion, philosophy, and ideology. It also includes communal information, informal education, and technology.
She's a very erudite person in academics, and we are very proud of her, particularly in gender studies. She's the expert we have both in Nigeria and internationally in gender studies and oral African literature, as far as we know.
Feminism. Simply put, feminism is about women. The belief that women should have equal rights and opportunities as men. Feminism can be described as a collection of movements and ideologies that share a common goal to define, establish, and achieve equal political, economic, cultural, personal, and social rights for women. Feminism has become a cross-cutting theory in contemporary scholarship.
I'm sure after this, most people will focus more on gender that have been neglected so far, both male and female.
And criticism. Despite the obvious lack of agreement on what constitutes feminist writings among critics, the general consensus is that feminist literature is a work written in a prejudiced way to favor the status of women. Very often, the feminist writer adopts a negative portrayal of the male in her work in protest against the previously damaging female portrayal in many male writings.
It didn't just discuss only the female gender, it also discussed the problems of the male gender.
Its goal, the emancipation of all women from sexist oppression, it failed to take into consideration the peculiarities of black females and other women of color. In practice, feminism concentrated on the needs of middle-class white women in Britain and America while posing as a movement for the emancipation of women globally. The term womanism is said to have been coined by Alice Walker in a collection of essays titled In Search of a Mother's Guidance.
It's my first time. It's okay. I feel good, it's nice, it's okay.
Womanism and the indigenous African woman. In my study of the African experience in gender discourse, I've observed that while it is indisputable that womanism is very relevant to all black women's situation, nevertheless, on closer examination, the use of womanism to cover the ideology that represents all black females and non-white women's experience needs to be interrogated. This is because womanism, as it's being used by critics today, lays more emphasis on the experiences of the African-American woman than it does on the African or other woman of color.
We work together on this because we have a committee on inaugural lectures, and she promised us she was going to do a beautiful presentation. The write-up, excellent. The presentation was also excellent. We are proud of her and we are proud to be associated with her.
Indigenous African gender concepts. Many African females feel uneasy about using the term feminism to denote the African female experience. This is so because there are glaring differences in the perception, worldview, and experiences of African females and their Euro-American sisters who involve the concept of feminism. The awareness that the West cannot speak authoritatively for Africa, as well as the need to integrate theory with practice, forms the basis for the search for alternative terminologies which adequately addresses the specificity of African female experiences. Ojuang Tayefo, the sky is big enough for all birds to fly without colliding. Again, Popo Injetibako Momo Komalala. meaning a farm cannot be jointly owned by a father and a child and be totally devoid of boundaries. This is the essence of the need to particularize the experiences of Africans and properly situate and locate the peculiarities of African women's experiences in gender discourse.
Professor is a Nigerian scholar, you know, well gifted, very active, you know, very active in scholarship, research, you know, has been able to produce many scholars as well, who mentors.
Gender politics in African literature, arbitrating the male writers and the African women. Honorable in 1997 notes that by omission or commission, most male writers in the early phase of African literature encouraged the marginalization of women. In other words, female characters are made marginal to the plot of the fiction, while only few emerge as powerful and incredible protagonists. According to Chukwuere, the ideal female character created by male writers often acts within the framework of our traditional roles as wife and mother. The cultural norms ensure that the respect and love which a woman earns is relative to the degree of our adaptation to these roles. For instance, while Chinua Achebe's Okonkwo in Things Fall Apart slaughters a goat for one of his wives, who has had three sons in a row, Lechi Amadi's Manume, and the concubine is demoralized by his wife's inability to produce a male child. A barren woman is stigmatized, considered a social misfit, and invites the wrath of a family and society. While the male writers generally malign or ignore female characters, some actually foreground the female experience in their works. However, although some male writers have foregrounded female characters, the male writers who use female protagonists fail to identify and explore the complexities of the women's lives, which partially constitutes a dilemma, the ambiguity in the perception of women's roles by these authors.
She has done excellently well today. As director of research for the university, I want to say that even to score her, she scored an A grade in the presentation.
Female writers and the African woman. The imagery of voicelessness of African females have been debunked by the number of African females engaged in gender discourse in recent years. All the genres of literature are explored as avenues by African female writers to add their voices to gender discourse. The unfavorable portrayal of women by African male writers ignited a literary outburst, which culminated in female writers' attempt to counter the impaired picture of African womanhood by reversing the roles of women in African fiction written by men. African female writers began to present female protagonists who are pitted against all odds, yet again liberated and determined to exist with or without the man. In a typical African female writing, the woman is the protagonist. She's often industrious, dynamic, and resourceful rather than weak, docile, and dependent. Female characters are imbued with the qualities of independence, dynamism, and industry with the society, even though associated with the male. This is the case of Ada, in which a Nechita set of class citizen failures in our Elsa Lewis, Woman at Point Zero, Ramatulaye, and Aisatu in Maria Baba's Solemn Letter, Lee in Zainab Akali's The Stillborn, Eagle Woman in Akachi Ezebo's House of Symbols, among many others.
She has been able to explain today. It is a concern for any nation that is planning to develop. That is, there should be complementarism between the male and the female gender. And she has well explicated that. And I'm sure that all stakeholders will take note of this and make good use of the recommendations that she had.
Gender stereotypes. Gender stereotypes are sets of cultural expectations popularly adopted by the mass majority. Common gender stereotypes and norms include the following examples. A man has a right to assert power over a woman and is socially superior. A man has a right to correct or discipline female behavior. A woman alone is responsible for making marriage work. Stereotyping of women has been a huge disadvantage for the advancement of women socially. Common gender stereotypical qualities of women are submissive, quiet, weak, passive, and incompetent. Because social pressure to fulfill these systematically enforced by parents, friends, teachers, and the media, many women conform to these qualities. They refrain from speaking their minds, become passive in strength-related activities, and do not progress and thrive at work because of insecurity and the pressure of wifehood and motherhood. It is noteworthy that those who do not conform to gender roles are often considered harsh, controlling, or manly, even in the workforce. Mr. President, Vice Chancellor, sir, many women, including me, have been nicknamed Margaret Thatcher to indicate their assertiveness, toughness, and firmness, which some erroneously perceive as aggressiveness and arrogance.
She's my academic mentor, and I'm very proud to be here today.
The construction of womanhood in Yoruba origin. Yoruba origin, especially proverbs, sayings, and stories, contain philosophical underpinnings that demonstrate the depiction of women. These depictions are paradoxical, sometimes positive, and other times negative. The following proverbs and writings illustrate the depiction of womanhood in Yoruba origin. Negative. Obirin o se finu mo. Women are untrustworthy. Obirin leke, obirin lodale. Women are deceitful. Women are traitors. In opposition to the above, some oral texts depict women positively. Examples include Iyanura, Babanidini, mother is golden, the father is very immune. And in Tiolodun, Tibotekodele, no soipe, obirin o si laye, it's only the half-wit, the one without some education that declares women are insignificant.
The high standard for me because of her.
Yoruba drum poetry. Anya, show wambe.
No way, no way. Alu do a tidi go. Alabani jo, amarani mo. Only the wise, the only go drum is beaten in proverbs. Only the wise can win its dance. Only the knowledgeable can be called its name. Drum, dance, and songs are the heart of African artistic imagination, image making, creativity, inventiveness, and social entertainment. While the Yoruba talking drum is used for music making and entertainment, its significance goes beyond these functions. Yoruba talking drum is used as a means of conveying messages. These messages are conveyed in diverse forms as songs, rhymes, poems, proverbs, aphorisms, witty sayings, and wise sayings. The Yoruba talking drum is an important instrument of history, philosophy, literature, poetry, and music, all put together.
The main goal is that you want a primary three to be able to understand what your field is all about, and that's the essence of inaugural lecture. So it was quite demanding.
Yoruba women in drumming. The art of drumming has traditionally been viewed as a male-dominated indigenous art. As such, Yoruba drumming is not an ascribed feminine role. This accounts for the paucity of Yoruba female drummers. Although women feature prominently in indigenous Yoruba musical performances, there are more of singers and dancers and less of drummers, especially or talking drummers.
Next thing now is to mentor more professors, because when you are inaugurated as a professor, you want to get many more people into the profession. And it's going to be quite fun.
Gender and the culture dilemma. Aside the fact that culture comprises the way of life and beliefs of a people, culture is also the process of development of the mind and the soul of man. A cultured person is a person who is developed in mind and soul, an enlightened person. Culture is related to the word cultivate. To cultivate is to enhance the growth of a thing. Therefore, culture is a process of cultivating attitudes, behavioral patterns, qualities, characteristics, methods, ideals, customs, ethics, and beliefs that are needed to bring about the well-being of any community or nation. Culture can be entrenched through literature and music. An idea becomes part of the culture of a people through constant repetition, experience, observation, exposure, and reiteration. Culture has an enormous impact on gender roles in any society. African culture in its totality is not anti-woman, although some aspects of the culture are unfavorable to women and some otherwise good aspects have been abused by societies to subjugate women. Nonetheless, the culture cannot be totally disregarded. the culture of any society constitutes its distinctive identity. Any groups of people who lose their culture also lose their identity.
Women. They need to be hardworking. They don't have to look at their weaknesses or other responsibilities. They should know and believe in themselves that they can balance these responsibilities. The home does not have to suffer, yet your work does not have to suffer. So, with God's help, all things are possible.
My contributions to scholarship. As a lecturer, I've been involved in undergraduate and graduate teaching, research, mentoring, and supervision. My contribution to scholarship can be categorized into two distinctive yet intersected areas: Yoruba drum poetry, fieldwork in oral literature and African women's theories, and criticisms.
From the discourse, you can see that women-related issues have taken the front burner. And with the discourse, we continue from now on. Women are not second-class citizens. The way God created them from the rib of the man shows what the scholar call complementarity. So we should give women their rightful places, and I think that has been adequately put across by the inaugural lecturer of today.
African women's theories and criticism. My book, Feminism and Gender Discourse, the African Experience, has been a trailblazer in this regard. My books have brought me to the limelight among established and emerging scholars of gender studies. My passion for gender studies bettered the Gender and African Studies Group, Bradford University, popularly known as BUGAS, which has attracted membership from several other universities and higher institutions. Selected academic engagements outside Bradford University. Mr. President, Vice Chancellor, sir, permit me at this point to mention some of my engagements beyond Bradford University. I've served as external examiner for PhD and master's thesis at my alma mater, the University of Ibadan, Nigeria, as well as other universities mentioned. In 2013, I served as a visiting professor, scholar in residence at the African Studies Institute, the University of Georgia, UGA, where I co-taught courses with UGA faculty. I presented a highly applauded seminar titled Yoruba Drum Language, Aesthetics, Cultural Retentions and Transmissions. Discovering the need at the Institute, I mobilized and coordinated the editing of the previous conference papers with the Institute had posted. This culminated in the publication of two volumes, one of which I'm an editor. The networking has also continued in other co-authored works with faculty from UGA. My time at UGA also introduced me to networks from the University of Florida, where we also have a mushrooming networking. Contributions to the community. Co-founder, Vision Center. Vision Center is a registered faith-based NGO, which is aimed at improving literacy and living standards among women, youths, and high school dropouts, among other things. It has library facilities which comprise literature books, preaching, and motivational books. All students enrolled in the free computer training are made to read a minimum of one book per week. The library is also open to the public. Vision Center also provides grants and loans, counseling, and empowerment programs to women. Editor, Intercessors Magazine. Intercessors is a magazine for spiritual upliftment and Christian living. Since 1997, when I got married, Intercessors has been distributed widely and freely, nationally and internationally. It has recorded remarkable success in impacting lives and encouraging Christian living. My recommendations. Mr. President, Vice Chancellor, sir, having highlighted issues in gender matters and the cultural dilemma in Africa, the following are my recommendations. Establishment of Bradford University Institute for Gender and African Studies. Gender and culture-related research, creative and critical writings, and gender awareness. Acknowledgement. I am John Benibe. Eruwabaliwoba. Oh, yeah, no one do pets in me. No one do pets in me. No one do pets in me.
Indigenous African humanism with the following characteristics.
characteristics is central to resolving the apparent dilemma. A dialogic, accommodationist approach, healthy appreciation of African cultures, specific concern of the African woman, recognition of the heterogeneity of African cultures, realistic and wholesome strategies devoid of unnecessary aggressiveness, pragmatism, and sensitivity to fellow women. Literature, oral, and written has the potential to reshape gender relations in Africa without dislocating the culture. My position is that there should be gender equity, which implies that behavior, aspirations, and needs of women and men are valued and perceived equally without prejudice. It does not mean that women and men have to be the same, but that their rights, responsibilities, and opportunities in life should not depend on their sex. Mr. President, Vice Chancellor, sir, I crave your indulgence to say a sincere thank you to everyone.
Congratulations. On behalf of the Vice Chancellor, I think she has paid her dues. You agree with me? I therefore inaugurate you fully as Professor of Gender and African Affairs.
Focused and you know where you're going, you definitely will get there with God's help. For me, my prayer has always been, Lord, establish the work of my hands and let your favor be upon me.